Hey guys, this is your friend Faye from Geekerwan. Today, let's talk about how to overclock your GPU. I assume you already know that GPU is the main factor when it comes to gaming performance, right? So by overclocking GPU, you might be lucky to get some sweetie extra numbers on your FPS count. That couldn't be wrong, huh? Just keep in mind, any kind of overclocking can have a possibility on damaging hardware, so always do it the right way. Be careful with your temperature, your cooling solution, maybe voltage, etc, etc, and you will be fine. Well, let's begin to dig in. So in this video, I want to do three levels of overclocking. The easy way, the normal way, and the hardcore way. Yeah, we gotta do some hardcore shit. For NVIDIA users, regardless of which way you want to apply, you need to download a tool called MSI Afterburner. Well, technically, there is a lot of options when it comes to overclocking tools, but personally, I think Afterburner has a pretty solid curve editor, which is a key to your overclocking experience. For RTX 30 series users, you might have to download the latest beta version of 4.6.3, which is ironically not available on the official site. Also, remember, this tool is for any overclockable NVIDIA cards, any vendors, not just MSI cards, so don't be tricked by the name, okay? No need to worry about your brand. So first, let's talk about the easy way, aka automatic overclocking. Sounds pretty promising, huh? You can click the button here to find the OC scanner and just click scan. After a long wait, the software will automatically find a stable clock speed for your GPU and you're just gonna apply it. That's it, your extra performance is ready now. You see, I called it an easy way for a reason, right? Well, actually, it's not that easy, because I would suggest you to do some tests afterward to see whether your card can survive that OC, even if it's automatic. And the tool we're using here is 3D Mark. You can definitely check out this stress test to make sure your GPU performs stable, after which you can run some benchmarks to see whether your graphics score has been increased. Personally, I use TimeSpy for modern GPUs. Also, if you don't want to pay for 3D Mark, you can just run the free demo version. It's not a big deal. Meanwhile, you can also test your card in different games. Some games are even more demanding than 3D Mark. So passing 3D Mark doesn't necessarily mean you are safe. That's something to keep in mind, okay? After you prove your OC is stable, you can save it as a profile for convenience. And you can click the button here to enable running Afterburner with Windows startup, so you will get this OC every time you start a computer. And that is basically how to overclock your NVIDIA cards easily. For AMD users, it's even easier than this, because you can just overclock your card in Radeon software, which is your GPU's control panel. You don't even have to download any extra tools. You can just go to the Performance tab, go to Tuning section, and find this Overclock GPU option here under Auto Tuning. This is kind of like the official way to overclocking AMD GPU. Basically, if you don't give a damn about these silicon shits and you just need some no-brainer, straightforward, extra gaming power, then automatic overclocking kind of works, but honestly, that won't be a lot. If you want to unleash all the potential from your card, you definitely need to do it yourself. So that brings us to the next level of OC, aka the normal way. For now, we've already downloaded Afterburner, and as you can see, we do have some options to toggle with. The first thing you want to do is to push your power limit to its absolute top end. When graphics card vendors design their cards, they won't exploit all the power potential your card has. So usually cards will have some extra power headroom that you can utilize yourself. Just top out the power limit, that would be fine. Then we're gonna slowly increase our core clock speed. This is the main part of overclocking, the teasing part. The teasing part, yeah. All right, you want to increase your core clock speed a little bit every once. Apply it and try to figure out whether it's a stable clock speed. Like what I'm doing here, I increase about 50 megahertz and then do a 3D Mark stress test. After a while, I pass the stress test without any problems spotted, so I know adding 50 megahertz is safe. Then I'm gonna push another 50 megahertz to 100 megahertz to see whether it can survive that. I guess at this point, you kind of get how it works, right? We're just gonna push it further and further and further until your card can't hold it anymore. At some point, maybe it will fail the stress test, so you nail the clock speed is simply too high for your silicon. Or maybe it's just getting too high, resulting throttling, in which case you might see the score decrease in benchmarks. So that's the point you realize, okay, that's it. No more, it's way too high, and I gotta pull it back a little bit and try again. And if it still fails, you pull it back a little bit more and try again and again until there is no problem at all. It's a little bit complicated, but I know you guys are clever as hell, you will get it, I guess. Also, the number you can squeeze from your card is kind of random. You might find two cards look the same, having very different overclocking potential. This is called silicon lottery among PC enthusiasts. For us, every OC feels like an adventure, or maybe gold rush, because you never know what a silicon can be until you try it. Yeah, we're literally the Indiana Jones of PC guys, I guess. For most cars, core clock is all you need to push, but for certain cars like Nvidia's MX series, I mean that entry-level shitting laptop, yeah. I would suggest trying some memory overclocking, since these cards really suffer from low memory bandwidth. Sometimes you can push the memory clock to a very high point, but be careful, make sure you don't spot any artifacts when running stress tests. Pushing memory too high could be problematic sometimes. Alright, that is how you overclock your GPU normally. For AMD users, it's the same principle. You can do it inside your Radeon software. Just enter manual mode and here you go. Well, I hope you can still catch up with me because we are now stepping into the hardcore territory. Yeah, let's talk about the hardcore way of OC, aka curve tuning. From now on, we will try to utilize the curve of frequency slash voltage. If you can carry out this technique correctly, you can not only do some extreme overclocking, but also try some undervolting to keep your temperature low, which I guess is pretty useful. For those who want to overclock your car to its absolute limit, the first thing you want to do is to find a BIOS with higher power limitation. Sometimes your card will have a pretty restricted power limitation, which can really hold you back. You can judge it by this perf cap reason indicator in GPU-Z. If it says power when you're testing OC, then it means power limit becomes the bottleneck, and you might want to flash a better BIOS. For example, I'm using an RTX 2060 with a maximum power limit of 175W, which is really not a big number, because when I try to push the card, it constantly reaches the power limit. 2060 is far beyond a bad card, but obviously my variant is not a high-end version of it. So we're gonna find the BIOS of a high-end model of 2060 with higher power limit and flash that BIOS on my 2060. To find the suitable BIOS, I would suggest you go to the Tech Power Up. They have this BIOS collection site, and you can search for the BIOS you want. The power limit of each card will be shown here, so your priority is to find a card with bigger numbers of these. But this is not the whole story. You can't just flash a random BIOS and hope it works. You need to consider compatibility issues like power connectors, video port layout, fan strategy, or even different core variants for different cards. My 2060 has one 8-pin power connector, so I'm going to find a card who also has one 8-pin connector. And look what I found here! This Pally card with one 8-pin connector not only has a massive 225W limit, which is more than enough for 2060, but also shares the same video port layout of my card, which means my port will hopefully be compatible with the new BIOS. Sometimes if you flash a BIOS with different port layout from your card, some of your ports will not work anymore. The same goes for your fans, like you might find them maybe stop spinning or going full speed for no reason, so you might have to find another BIOS. That's something to consider. Disclaimer! Flashing BIOS may void your warranty, so be careful with that. If you don't want to play hard, you don't have to do this. Also, for high-end cards like 2080 Ti or 3080, I would recommend a site on overclock.net called Owners Club. Many graphics cards have their Owners Club, and on this site, you will find a lot of useful information, including difference between each card, difference between core variants, BIOS recommendation, OC tips, and BIOS flashing instruction, which is something we are going to talk about right now. Since we have found the suitable BIOS, we just need to download and flash it. The tool we're using here is NVFlash. Usually, you can download the official version, but for some cars like a Founders Edition, you might have to use a modified version of NVFlash since these cars have some sort of ID verification you need to bypass. I will just use the official version here. To flash your BIOS, you can first create a new folder under the root directory and put both NVFlash and your BIOS into the folder. You might want to rename your file for your convenience. And now, let's open up the CMD with administrator permission. Change directory to that NVFlash folder. Turn off your BIOS protection. And maybe back up your current BIOS in case something goes wrong. And flash the BIOS you prepare. Follow the instructions it tells you, then you're ready with your shining new BIOS. Look at these numbers! My car can't wait to prove itself now. So it's time to introduce curve tuning. You see this little step icon beside your core clock speed bar? This is where magic happens, it's the curve editor. The purpose of curve tuning is to fix the point of voltage and frequency so you can keep your frequency stable from the impact of boost mechanism. Without curve tuning, the boost mechanism of your GPU will automatically pick a point on your curve depends on your current temperature or workload, so it might not be the point you want. That's why we need curve tuning to designate the specific frequency and voltage point for your GPU. But before we actually use the curve editor, we should first perform a normal overclocking with this new BIOS. You know what I'm talking about when I say normal overclocking, right? This is for defining the fundamental shape of your curve. If you just tune the curve directly, since the foundation of your curve is pretty low, the clock speed might drop pretty heavily when your GPU is indeed overheating or reaching power limit. By kicking up the foundation of your curve, that drop could be much smoother. Since we've done that already, let's start the journey of curve. If you want to play hard with curve, I would suggest you unlock the voltage control in setting menu before trying to do anything. This will allow you to extend the voltage limit. Some cars might not have this option, but don't worry, it's not necessary. It's only for extreme circumstances, so let's just keep going. The first thing you want to do is to find a suitable voltage point. For most desktop NVIDIA cards, when you push the voltage limit to its end, you can probably reach a maximum voltage of 1.093, which is this point. If you have an awesome cooling solution like water cooling or something, you can definitely use this high voltage point. And you want to pull it up a little bit to the clock speed you want to reach. For this 2060, we can probably push it to maybe 2085 MHz. Let's just try it. Now, before you click the apply button, you want to press Ctrl and L. As you can see, when you press Ctrl and L, it generates a line on your curve. Once you see this line, you can now apply it. And it will lock down the clock speed and voltage at the fixed number you want. Maybe not exactly, but it should be close. So now, we can run some tests to find out whether you can survive that clock speed. Alright, seems like it's pretty stable, but as you may notice, our clock speed drops pretty soon because our temperature is climbing up way too quickly. I think this 1.093 voltage point is just way too high for our cooling solution. It might cause overheating over time, like constantly reaching 80 degrees or something. So I would drop it to maybe 1.05, which is much more cooling friendly. I will get back to our foundation, which is normal profile, start from here, and try to find out the highest stable clock speed available on this 1.05 voltage point. Still, remember to press Ctrl and L when you want to lock and apply your setting. Once you find the ideal clock speed and the temperature looks good for you, you can just stay with this frequency slash voltage point. And that is basically how hardcore overclocking works. Let me summarize the whole thing. First, find and flash a suitable BIOS to break through the power limit. Second, push your power and the voltage limit to its top end and try to perform a normal OC. You know what I'm talking about, right? Third, play with different voltage points in your curve editor to find out how much voltage is suitable for your card. And finally, find the best stable clock speed at that certain voltage point. Keep those in mind and you can be the expert of overclocking GPUs. By the way, like I mentioned, this curve editor is equally important for undervolting as well as overclocking. If you want to massively reduce heat and power consumption of your card, you can pick a very, very low voltage point in your curve and try to find a suitable clock speed on that. This is basically how Nvidia do their max Q thing on laptop. Also, the curve editing approach is only for Nvidia users. If you're an AMD user, your hardcore OC might include a pretty different approach, and the technique can differ from card to card, so it's a little bit complicated. If you guys are interested in that, I will try to explain it in a future video maybe. So that's it. This is the tutorial on how to overclock your GPU. Hopefully it won't be too difficult for you to understand. And if you like the video, make sure to hit the like button and subscribe to our channel. We will bring you some really cool stuff soon. So stay tuned and see you next time.